Thanks for the introduction. Thanks for the full house. Sorry to disappoint, I am not Suresh. I listed myself as second author, but just came out with his name in the program, so bear with me. So I'll be the one today talking to you about the role of invasive brown goby in the Great Lakes Basin, and touching on habitat use and standing stock biomass in a recently invaded deep lake. I'll be talking about Cayuga Lake today, just north of Ithaca, New York. And this was done in conjunction with a course that was developed in the Department of Natural Resources at Cornell University. So I'll point out the instructors and all the students that helped out with this project. Thanks. I'll provide a little bit of background about why we did the study and about round goby in general, and then talk about the Cayuga Lake survey that we conducted, and also some monitoring and ecological implications of this work. Okay, this one I may have to do on here. So, in 2016, Matt Kobe and Suresh and I went out for one of his projects looking at Cisco, and we wanted to check out a videography approach to do substrate assessments. And before I went out, a few of my friends asked, like, well, you're going to put a camera down, you're going to see a bunch of stuff. And I said, no, it's okay, it's working. I didn't think we'd see anything at all, and I was clearly wrong. That's an 8-inch by 8-inch square, and it's just loaded with goby. So I was really impressed, and we decided, hey, we should do this with round goby for an assessment tool. So a little bit more about round goby. They have been on the move around the globe for quite some time. They spread throughout Europe in the 60s, through the 90s, and then really started to rapidly expand around 2000. And they're still expanding today. So we've got new goby populations popping up in the Upper Elbe River in 2015, and then 2016, six Baltic streams in Estonia. Goby turned up there. Our first experience was 1990. An angler caught around goby in the St. Clair River. And they've spread more quickly through the Great Lakes than basically any other invasive fish that we've experienced here, aided by ballast exchanges within the Great Lakes, and also multiple reintroductions from the Black Sea and the Baltic Sea based on some genetic evidence that's been shown. They continue to spread to inland lakes and rivers and streams with access to more and more inland systems through connections like the Erie Canal. So they popped up. There's Cayuga Lake on the right. They first observed there in 2011. Again in 2012, and then 35 miles south of there in 2013. They popped up on the southern end of the lake. And in 2017, an angler for a fishing derby in Seneca Lake turned in a rainbow trout with a round goby in its stomach. They have not been confirmed in the lake, but take that for what it's worth. So some traits that facilitate round goby establishment and proliferation are their salinity tolerance. So they grow best at about 5 to 10 parts per thousand salt, but they can tolerate fresh water to basically nearly marine environments. They're also temperature tolerant. They can handle temperatures from -1 to 30 degrees Celsius, and they grow optimally at around 26. Oxygen tolerance, another one important for fish. From about 0.5 to 1.5 milligrams per liter is their critical threshold of oxygen. And they also have partial cutaneous respiration, so they can breathe a little bit through their skin. And they're repeat spawners. So some of the studies that have been done in the Baltic and other systems across the ocean have found that females can produce 5 to 6 clutches in a single spawning season. So as predators, round goby consume, here in North America, a lot of dry-sinned mussels, also a variety of different invertebrates. And they've been known to consume fish eggs as well as fish larvae. And as competitors, they compete with a lot of our native fish out there. A lot of different sculpin, darters, juvenile yellow perch, for example. And this has been found through observations in the lab and also in the wild, and suspected from habitat overlap. But they also serve as prey to a lot of things. I've only put the fish up here, but don't forget about the birds and snakes as well. The Lake Erie water snake consumes a lot of goby. And these are kind of our primary species that have been reported to focus largely on goby. So we've got burbot up there, lake sturgeon, smallmouth bass, walleye, northern pike, brown trout, lake trout, and yellow perch. And goby also have an interesting characteristic of moving energy around in kind of a unique pathway that, really wasn't there before the goby arrived. So because around goby eat mussels, they move that energy when they move. So in the winter, our goby are down here. They're kind of blending in there, but there they are. So the population in general has gone offshore to deep areas of the lake, and they stay there until the spring when the water warms up and they move up into the water column. And they move that energy from those deeper areas up to different predators that are found in shallow water versus, let's say in this case, walleye and lake trout, which are deeper in these systems. So our survey, we wanted to build upon previous efforts. Certainly people have done videography before, but we wanted to add some things to that. And with the goal of determining around goby summer and winter distribution and habitat use, so depth and substrate type where they were located, and quantify density and standing stock biomass. And basically use this information to inform how round goby might be interacting with other species, fish, invertebrates, things like that. And we thought that the videography approach would perform well in Cayuga Lake and could be applicable in the Great Lakes. And that round goby movement and habitat use and potential interactions with other species would be similar to what we had or what has been observed in the Great Lakes. So our data sources, we went out in July and August. We did 18 transects, one pretty much every couple miles up Cayuga Lake, and did five camera drops or deployments, three shallow and two deep. And kind of the cutoff there to classify those two categories was the bottom of the thermal coin. Snorkeling surveys, observations were done in the thick vegetation on the north end of Cayuga Lake where the videography wasn't quite as effective. And there was also a continuous long point snorkeling survey, which Suresh was really the lead on. And then data coverage in January. Matt and Suresh just finished up our winter survey on Saturday. We did seven transects there with about four camera deployments at each with a range of depths. So here's our frame. We call it the cage, but it's got our camera on it, mounted at the top here. We've got a GoPro right here with a way to collect some ancillary data, which I'll talk about later. We've got dive lights mounted in the corners, and we're also collecting conductivity, temperature, and depth along with this. And we've got some reference along the bottom there for length. So a lot of things at work all at once, a lot of moving parts, but seem to work out okay. We also categorized our substrate types, so from 0 to 4, 4 being that's all that presence, or 0, the absence of whatever it was. So our vegetation, this is an example of an image here that we would have ranked a 4, so all vegetation. Mussels and silt were our other two primary substrates, so there's a image of that, some more complex habitat there. Then a little bit deeper, we saw these really high densities of mussels. Basically, that's all that's there, so that's a 4 category on mussels. And then as we went deeper, those mussel densities declined, and we saw more that silt substrate. Okay, so these are mean goby counts. We selected 6 minutes because of this data and what we observed here. We had three different observers look at these videos. And what we saw was some dispersal at the beginning when the cage first hit the lake bottom, and then fish started to move back in. So we wanted to catch that peak density and do it with multiple observers to correct for detection probability of these fish. So that's our counts, and those are our minutes through time. And again, you can see that peak for all three of our observers at minute 6. Okay, this is our goby counts at 6 minutes as a function of depth. And basically we can see we've got a lot of zeros, but nothing, no observations of any goby during the summer survey, basically beyond 20 meters depth. Here's a way that we decided to look at the habitat. in different substrates. So we've got vegetation in the black squares, and we've got mussels in the gray circles, and silt in the lighter gray triangles. And what I kind of take away from this, these are mean goby counts and then the different scores of those habitats, is if you look out where there's the four, it's 100% of anything, it seems like there's relatively low numbers there compared to more complex substrate types. Based on the snorkeling surveys, around goby were present in that north end that's highly vegetated, but in relatively low densities to where we found goby present in other locations. And we did find round goby pretty much all around the lake, but again, in those near shore areas where it was less than 20 meters. And those are shown in the black circles there where fish were present versus the open white circles where we did not observe round goby. And these are some data from that snorkeling survey I mentioned at Long Point. And this is the depth of the maximum goby density in meters. The larger the circle, the more dense the observation, through time, and also with water temperature on the right axis there. And what we see basically is fish moving deeper and deeper. That follows a change in temperature until Suresh couldn't observe anything beyond 7 meters. And this is gonna just keep switching on me. I'm kind of glad I wasn't there that day. He put in some time and effort. And it was a cold one in November. So the winter sites, we didn't get to as many sites, but we did see some interesting things. More or less what we expected. At these 30 sites, we found goby were present in 45 to 70 meters of water, and nothing shallower than that, nothing deeper than that either. We've got some more analysis to do. We've got some next steps coming up. I mentioned that GoPro, that video was actually taken from outside of the field of view. So that was really intended to find out how far we were attracting fish. So what's our effective trap size, so to speak, or what's our attraction area into our field of view. And then we want to scale that up. We were able to get head widths with our length reference, and we want to scale that up to biomass in the future. So that's coming up. Monitoring implications of this work, we really thought it was an effective technique, and it worked in shallow and deep stations. We got down to almost 400 feet in Cayuga Lake. We felt we reduced some bias that's present with some other approaches by correcting for the detection probability with those three observers. We did have some limitations. If there's low visibility in the water, obviously the round goby are going to be difficult to see. And in those vegetated areas, it was not quite as effective as the more open areas. As I mentioned, we kind of have to consider that attraction area. So what is our effective sampling size? How far are we drawing fish in over the course of this 6-minute time frame? And something that I refer to as the edge effect is another thing to consider, but I think we can probably overcome that pretty easily. So this is a still frame of our cage. You can see the length reference here. We've got a round goby inside the cage, then he's got two friends over here and three heads popping in on the far side there. What we observed was fish approaching that frame and then looking like they were deterred by it. So they went right up to it and then stopped. They were reluctant to go over the top. They eventually would, but this would be something to think about and could be overcome by simply using a tripod approach without a frame on the bottom, and we just have three legs on it, and then they have full access to the field of view. Ecologically, the Great Lakes information has been available, and that's great, but we've got some new perspective now from an inland system that's similar to some others, like Seneca Lake, that may experience invasions in the future. Certainly, with what we found, there's potential for overlap with some sport fish species, depending on the season and the habitat that they prefer. So as an example, let's say salmon and trout eggs that are deposited in streams in the late fall when round goby are moving offshore might be less susceptible to round goby, while bass or perch eggs that are deposited in the spring when the fish are there in the littoral zone may be more susceptible to being consumed by goby. And as was found in other places, depending on the time of the year, there's some competition potential with smaller native species as well. And as I mentioned, overlapping spatially depending on the time of year and the habitat you're in, with multiple different invertebrate species. With respect to what we found, really we had a narrow summer distribution. So if you're sampling in the summer and you're just doing it near shore, you may think that there's a lot more goby out there if you're applying what your thoughts are in that area of the lake to the rest of the lake. So really something to consider is lake morphology. A lake like Oneida Lake, which is shallow all the way around, and there's work being done there too, may have goby habitat everywhere. And then your density near shore may be representative of the whole system. But this is a steep-sided, deep lake with kind of a unique setup that is more similar to the Great Lakes, I would say. And importantly, that movement of energy from mussels to predators, I think, is a really important part of the role that round goby play in the environment. It's just, again, kind of a new and novel energy pathway. So with that, I'll thank our video processors. We had a bunch of volunteers come out in the field, and also some folks give us some gear. And again, everybody that helped with the project in the class. And with that, well, I thought I had a question slide in there somewhere, but it says thank you.